Hello, ladies and gentlemen, it's Alex Petrescu, your favorite finance and accounting trainer here on my channel on YouTube. Let's just say that I have been very, very busy. I have shared in the past or in my previous video some information with you, what I have to, what I want to do in the future, what are my plans. Let's just say that I was going farther with the improvement of my courses, which are already presented on Udemy. So taking care of the captions, taking care of the chapters. So captions are like the subtitles, in case you don't understand what I'm saying. My language sometimes is not very clear. Maybe if I'm also a little bit tired and everybody's making mistakes. You have the alternative on all my courses on Udemy. You have the alternative to switch on these subtitles, these captions, and to see the writing of my words actually. I have been working also on the chapter split for my existing courses on Udemy. It will still be a lot of work behind it. I have done a little bit of rebranding, let's say so. Namely, I think I have found the image for my channel and for my courses, the course images, how they will look, so template. Also the thumbnails for the videos on YouTube and so on and so forth, and I think it's a very nice one. I've spent a lot of time looking at several alternatives to design that. In the end, I remained with Adobe Spark as an option. I tried to look also at Canvas and Canva. I think there are some alternatives. And I have now a new let's say image of the channel. Then I have finalized the dashboard course, so conceptually that the content was finalized, and I actually managed to film the course as well. It should be in no time available on a new platform. Actually, it's a new course, so there is no overlap so far with Amy, and the dashboard course will be available on learnfly.com. So it's a totally new platform besides what I have been using so far with Udemy, which is a dedicated learning platform, and Patreon, which is, let's say, for content creators more. This course will be, at least in the beginning, available only on LearnFly. Of course, it was a lot of work behind it, and also I had to put up the presentation for what we are going to talk today in this video. Long story short, today we are going to talk about alternative performance management systems. I have said also capitalism for dummies. I don't know if it's about the people that fail to learn these concepts in school. They simply don't believe in them. They want with any price to invent something new, to show the world that they have new ideas and so on and so forth. There are some, of course, I'm also interested in this because it's my profession and it's normal to be curious, which I recommend to all of you always, to stay curious about profession, to find out what's new in your profession, what kind of innovations are there, if they're really valuable. Sometimes they're not that valuable, as we will see. And I'm curious and I'm taking a look at what kind of ideas other people come in the, let's say, in this direction of performance management and measuring a company's performance and so on and so forth. And I felt the need at some point to step in because the things are getting pretty wild and crazy, and there is the need of having some, at least one cool head, maybe there are some others, to remind the basics and the things which haven't changed in the meantime. I mean, if you drop an apple, it still falls towards the ground. And it's the same in the, let's say, in the economy, in the performance of the companies, in the macroeconomy, in the microeconomics, and it's nothing has changed. First of all, I don't want to throw a bad light on these guys. It's not my point. Probably there are some others. I have seen ideas here and there, but I have selected something. Because it looks like it's structured and these guys are promoting it, and Let's see what they are proposing here. So they are called Key M Trust and Partners, Executive Leadership. I think it's like a consultancy company in Romania. And they say new metrics for measuring a company's success. So first of all, it was not clear for me if I should read this. I mean, it's very colorful. If I should read it from bottom or from the top, it doesn't really matter. We go from bottom up. So they, what have they included here? They have included people, key people development, people, key people retention. So development and retention of people, in other words, investments in the well-being of employees and customers, meaningfulness at work, involvement in addressing at least one of the world's grand challenges, corporate social responsibility, employee involvement rate, engagement loyalty towards customer, customer engagement loyalty. So we need to be engaged towards our customers and they need to be engaged towards us. It's a two-way road, I guess. Employee engagement, so it should be real and authentic. They felt the need to say that. Return on stakeholder engagement and return on character. The first idea what I have to say and what I have noticed is that they have like 11 metrics, which is a performance system. With 11 measures, it's way too complex to work. No structure, no layering, no which one takes precedence, with which one we start, why this one's not the other, not others. So it just looks like a list of ideas. 100% all of them cost money, so investment in the well-being of employees. Yeah. Created gyms in the head offices or whatever that means. All of them cost money. Many of them might bring nothing. Also, some of them, like I will give you exactly the examples which I had in mind, can be second or third tier, so very good second or third tier objectives of a specific function in a company. For example, this key people retention and development is like a very good HR objective, yeah, a goal. Just like the involvement, engagement of the employees. Also, if you are talking about customer loyalty and loyalty of the company towards the customers, we can think in the area of marketing and sales, but they are not really the primary metrics, or they cannot function as primary metrics for defining success in a company. We will see why. I have put together a finance for non-finance course. It's available on both Udemy and Patreon. It's a very long one. It's explaining finance to professionals which are outside of the profession, people that didn't come into contact with finance and accounting personnel before. They want to understand them better, for improving the communication, for better collaboration, and so on and so forth. And I wanted to put it in the beginning. I wanted to put it at the start of the presentation. It ended up at the end of the presentation. And I put a list. And the question is, why do lucrative businesses? So I'm thinking, I'm trying to come up with the right words, not to suggest you the correct answer. Why a business exists? And I'm saying there specifically that I'm not talking about charities, not-for-profit organizations, committees, you name it. And the list of potential reasons I'm giving is making customers happy, providing jobs, paying directors large bonuses, nurturing competition in the marketplace, providing needed goods and services, so what the customers need, self-realization of employees, so that they feel good and they feel they have a career and a good position in the society, protecting the environment, buying the production of suppliers. The suppliers also need to sell their production to somebody. paying taxes, of course. And I'm saying that the reason why I came up with this list, and it's such a funny list of arguments and reasons why a lucrative business should exist, is because I never thought that somebody could come in the real life with a performance management system and with metrics that are in this direction and try to actually use it. So let's start with something which is called, which are the theories X and Y of McGregor. They were first explained in a book called The Human Side of Enterprise. They come from, let's say, from the types of behaviors the humans can have. And then they develop into two styles of management which can be applied each for one type of behavior. Then would be the authoritarian in the theory X and the participative in theory Y. You can find more details on under mindtools.com, or you can just Google it, and I'm quite sure you will find more about it if you don't know it already. Long story short, if you believe that your team members dislike their work and have little motivation, you'll use an authoritarian style of management. I said you will use the stick. It's this theory. What do you use to motivate people, the stick or the carrot? So you will use this sort of negative motivation, threatening them with bad things that can happen to them if they don't do their work. On the other hand, if you believe that your people take pride in their work and see it as a challenge, then you'll more likely adopt a participative management style. So you will use the carrot. So you will tell them that if they do their work very well, they will get something good out of it. Then the scarcities of resources and effort-effect relation. So what does resource scarcity mean? It's a central theme or a central point in the economics. Which says that there is a lack of availability of supplies required to maintain life or a certain quality of life. It's a fundamental idea. Scarcity is a perpetual problem for economic theory, which often assumes that humans have unlimited wants, which is actually true. As a society, as individuals, we have needs and wants only till we die. And we must find ways to fulfill these wants using scarce resource. And since the resources are scarce and we want so much, we are trying to optimize the things, meaning that we are trying to do as little effort as possible in order to obtain as much effect as possible. And the society is a sum of interactions between individuals and organizations and whatever kind of structures you want, which are trying to do this to each other at the expense of each other. So if we take the company Amazon, one of the most successful companies in the world, I think it's giving the also the richest person in the world, Jeff Bezos. And what he's saying is that, according to BusinessInsider.com, is Amazon is tracking the warehouse workers' every move because Jeff Bezos thinks people are inherently lazy. So he's very clearly an adept of the X theory of an authoritarian management style, and he doesn't think that people are motivated and they find fun in their activity. Then you have to ask yourself if he's right or wrong. One important thing which you need to have in mind is what kind of employees Amazon is having, mostly, not all of them. Well, they mostly have workers in the warehouses. Yeah. And one of the questions is, a worker that didn't went to college, because that's why he's worker most of the times, or didn't even finish high school or any, so not that much school, is inherently lazy or hardworking? You answer to this question for yourself. How appropriate is to use the participative theory, the theory X, the theory Y, on somebody, so on these workers, which are paid with minimum wage, they never get or seldom get salary increases, and they get no performance related bonuses. That is another question which you should ask yourself. How likely is that somebody paid with minimum wage will just want to minimize his efforts because there is nothing else to be done? Just as I have said, the effect is, in this case, the minimum wage is fixed. You cannot change it. So by putting a little bit more effort or a little more effort in it, you won't move this effect. How are you going to try to optimize this balance between effort and effect? Of course, you are going to try to reduce the effort. So I think that he might be onto something, Jeff Bezos. And think then where you can apply the theory, why the participative one, so the positive one, and can you not apply it with partners in a law firm, for example, or with employees and managers which are paid with bonuses related to company performance and so on and so forth. So in organization, where there are the people get clear objectives, they get periodic evaluations, they get rewarded for their performance, or contrary, they get punished for their lack of performance and so on and so forth. Then there are two great cinematographic illustrations, because we came from economics theory and McGregor and Amazon example and so on and so forth. But these two cinematographic illustrations are very clear. One is coming from the series called Billions, from Damian Lewis, the actor, which is playing Bobby Axelrod. And he's basically holding a speech in front of a college audience, and he's saying, so, and I'm here to give you a little bit about what the school has been holding back from you. The goddamn truth about Darwin, scarcity, so the idea of scarcity of resources, and the world you actually live in. It's populated by people like me who will tear you apart. Nature didn't select me, I selected myself by harnessing my nature. Ask him to go against his DNA, against the going against the human nature, which is telling each of you to be greedy. Yes, be hungry, subjugate and conquer, because that's who we are. That's what we are. Capitalism harnesses that better than any other economic model on earth. Everything we have is because of capitalism. Because someone had an incentive to get off his ass, to out-invent, to out-earn, yes, and to subjugate others less capable, less intelligent, less ambitious, and less lucky, to make those capitalistic dreams come true. He might sound like a jerk, you might not like what he's saying, but deep down inside, each and every one of us knows that he's telling the truth. No matter how infuriating that is, how irritating that is, no matter how nice we are striving to be, empathic, charitable, and so on and so forth, the essence is what he's actually saying. And then there is the Michael Douglas, which has portrayed Gordon Gekko in The Wall Street. Actually, there was a follow-up on that movie, which is twice as... It's very bad, the follow-up. But in the original movie, he's saying, the point, ladies and gentlemen, is that greed, for lack of a better word, is good. And then he's also having some philosophical consideration. He's saying, I create nothing, I own. So, do think about this stuff. Now, why do companies actually exist? The primary purpose of any existing company is to maximize shareholders' wealth, or owners, if it's not a shares company. Yeah? It can be one sole owner and the company might not be listed. It will want to maximize the owner's wealth. Shareholders' wealth gets maximized when the share prices increase and or the dividend payments are substantial. So it's a mix of these two. They can be in different percentages. So there are companies which are paying absolutely no dividends, but they're, because of that, they are reinvesting everything, and they are reinvesting everything very profitable. The prices are increasing a lot. There are companies which also have share price increases, but they are also paying some dividends and so on and so forth. At the level of the company, that translates into maximizing profit. So dividend payments are directly related to maximizing profit. And if the profits are maximized, also the other investors will trust the company and they will want to buy the shares and the share prices will grow. And for goal congruence, also we are looking at the bottom of the P&L, but we are also looking at the top line of the P&L. We want to also increase the revenues to increase the market share, because there can be a trade-off. Always you can just sell all your assets and make a lot of profit on the short term, and that doesn't mean that you have taken the best decision in the interest of the company. I'm saying that to keep the businesses and the capitalism system on track, it requires that the shareholders are wealthy and they take care through voluntary donations, sponsoring. For example, the former wife of Jeff Bezos is doing a lot of charity work and she's donating a lot of money. And through this means, you can try to also solve some of the other problems besides the efforts which the governments should put in this direction. For example, world grand challenges: education, poverty, hunger, pollution, health, access, waste, social responsibility. Yeah, there is no misinterpretation here. If there is a manufacturing company, let's say in the chemical industry, which is producing a lot of waste, a lot of pollution, and the level of pollutions are above the legal accepted ones, they should remedy the situation as fast as possible, be fined according to the legal requirements, remedy the situation, so do all the works necessary to bring the environment back to its state, and so on and so forth. However, if you take a company which is like a law practice or an architecture office or a software development company or a bank, and these kind of companies are in services and they don't pollute that much, and they all they do all day long is, and you see the chairmen and you see the press and you see the communication in social media and so on and so forth, and all they do is talk about their carbon footprint, I'm giving an example, or about making the world a better place or any other things like this, that's it's laughable. And I'm quite sure, because of their not focusing on their strategic objectives, which are in the areas of shareholders' wealth maximization, I'm quite sure that their management is detrimental for those companies. And at some point, maybe they should be removed from office. So this is basically what I was trying to say. It's nice to come with things like the companies exist to save the world, but it's so vague and it costs a lot of money, and to be honest, this is not why the shareholders are putting their money in these companies. If the shareholders, let's say somebody is very rich and has like $1 million and they want to use that money to save the world, they can go to an NGO, to Greenpeace, there are many others. There are organizations which help feeding, because on the list there was also hunger and so on and so forth, which help feeding children in Africa, and they can give that money to these charities and this sort of organization, and their money will go in the direction that they want to. If they are giving the money to companies, it's because they want something in return, and that's to maximize that money. Also, if you are doing very well in the business and you can be nice on the side, but after you do very well in the business, there is also no problem to be charitable as a secondary activity to help others. It's perfect. For example, in this metric system, it was something which is called return on character. I took a look at it. And somehow through studies, which personally I think it's 99% that they are mumbo jumbo, they have found out that the companies which were run by managers which were perceived as having character, whatever that means, are performing better. Yeah, I can tell you for sure that first the companies are performing better, and they are performing better not because the managers are have character, but on the side the managers also have character. If you just take somebody with character and you ask him to run a multi-billion business without having the required skills, the required experience, the required potential, and the required drive and motivation, he will fail for sure. That's everything what I wanted to tell you today. If you like my videos, please don't forget to like, share, and comment. So share if you think somebody is interested in the topics that I'm debating here. Comment if you have something to add, to contradict me, to support me, whatever you want to say. And most important, to subscribe to my channel. Also, four other ways through which you can support me. A, you can create an eToro account, because we are also talking in these videos about investment and how you can improve your wealth. You can create an eToro account and trade there without fees and commissions. No matter how often you trade, you will save some money. Then you can access the Amazon options with the two free Audibles and a Kindle program. I also have a Kindle. And last but not least, there is a Amazon wish list on which there are specifically items which would help me very much improve the quality of my videos, a better webcam, a green screen. Maybe we can do something like more dynamic, some animations. Maybe I can stand instead of just being pinned to this chair in my apartment. Some light system, I don't know, I think like now the light is not very good. It's depending on the conditions outside and on the light in my room. Some software, some better video editing software. I told you that I have somehow solved the problem of let's say visual identity for my channel, but still I could use some help, some latest version of Microsoft Office, a solution for filming these videos while I travel. So because right now I'm at least for the YouTube videos, for the courses I could do them also somewhere else, but for the YouTube videos I'm trapped with my camera, and I still need something. Since I have a desktop computer, I still need some other sort of mobile solution. Once again, thank you very much. In no time I will also launch a teaser for the new dashboard course. It will be also present here on YouTube, and I look forward to presenting to you and to talking to you in my next video. Bye.